Hello. Welcome to the Penny Stamps Distinguished Speaker Series. My name is Stephanie Tharp, professor in the Stamp School, and I'm happy to introduce our speaker, Kelly Murdoch-Kitt. Kelly joined the faculty at Stamps as an assistant professor in 2017 and previously taught as an assistant professor in the School of Design at the Rochester Institute of Technology. She's also taught in the graphic design programs at the University of San Francisco and California College of the Arts. She will speak today about her work, which explores how to improve the ways that people work together. Her recent projects span across disciplines and include process design for the improved care of heart patients, an online platform that fosters cross-disciplinary collaboration, and a long-running research project on improved human connection between remote collaborators from different cultural backgrounds. Kelly's work is incredibly timely. When everything transitioned to remote learning earlier this year, her work was top of my mind as she recently published a book about remote collaboration. This book, titled Intercultural Collaboration by Design, was written with her research partner, Associate Professor Denielle Emans. Their book introduces a framework for collaborating remotely across cultures, learning to use multicultural perspectives to address pressing global issues. Additionally, she was a recent University of Michigan Institute for the Humanities Research Fellow. She's received grants from the National Endowment for the Humanities and has been recognized within her discipline by the Design Incubation Communication Design Educator Awards. And now we'll join Kelly for her talk, The People Beyond the Screen, Designing for Human Connection.
Hi, everyone. First of all, thank you for that generous introduction. I'd like to dedicate this presentation to my lifelong conscience, Dorothy, and my daily inspirations, Jim and Tilden. And wherever you may be watching this, I want to thank you so much for joining me. I'm truly honored to be a part of the Penny Stamps Speaker Series, and also to be a part of the Stamps community. To my colleagues, students, and our alumni, even though most of us haven't seen each other face-to-face in a while, I still feel so connected to this creative, sensitive, and inclusive community that takes social and racial justice seriously. I'm an experienced designer who focuses on interpersonal communication and how interactions between people contribute to collaborative learning and co-creation. You might be more familiar with the term user experience designer, and as such, you might expect my creative work to take place mainly on screens. I'll show you some examples of recent screen-based project, but user experience designers don't just focus on creating functional digital products like mobile apps. We work to create conditions for optimal experiences in a range of contexts, whether that's in using a particular physical or digital product, or in an experience within a particular spatial environment, a service, a system, or a process. If you look up the definition of user experience design, it will probably say something along the lines of useful, usable, and desirable. And those goals are fine as a baseline. But I believe design must also be meaningful, change-oriented, and conscientious. My longest-running research project is about designing methods to improve human connection between remote collaborators from very different cultural backgrounds. It's probably because of my interest in human connection that I kind of dislike the dehumanizing word user, so I prefer experience designer, but I still sometimes use user experience or the shorthand UX. I'll share a screen-based UX project I'm working on with an interdisciplinary team to improve the care of heart failure patients, a 9-year research project that led to the recent publication of my book, which focuses on integrating visual thinking into the experience of intercultural and online collaboration, both of which are very relevant in our present moment. And related to that book, an online platform that helps people find intercultural collaborators. Essentially, all of these projects share common threads of helping people to work together better and to navigate processes of cultural learning and co-creative work by designing for human connection, empowerment, and mutual respect. Before I get into my book, I want to first introduce one of my screen-based projects to you. While the context of my book research is primarily focused on intercultural collaborations between students, I'm also interested in the application of these values and principles in other contexts. I've been able to take these values from my book research and apply them to this project, the Manage Heart Failure Decision Dashboard. This dashboard is being created by an interdisciplinary, multi-generational research team here at U of M, which includes faculty like myself, students, and researchers from fields such as cardiology, pharmacy, design, information science, computer science, and health policy. As we strive to develop a more effective interface for clinicians to access patient information, we must also navigate our different disciplinary cultures. This project is looking at how to streamline providers' access to patient data within the Electronic Health Record System, or EHR. This is also sometimes called EMR, which stands for Electronic Medical Records. The EHR, or EMR, is a secure online system that healthcare providers use to access patient information. Have you ever been to a doctor's appointment where it seems like your doctor is spending much more time looking at a digital interface than actually staring at your human face? Well, for me, one of the critical questions here is how streamlining that electronic health records experience might improve a sense of human connection in the exam room while empowering providers in terms of their decision making for their patients by putting all the information that they need in one place. Right now, we're focusing specifically on heart failure patients because this is currently the most common hospital discharge diagnosis among older adults in the United States. The cases are usually very complex, and this combined with their high readmission rate points to an urgent need to evolve the management of heart failure, which is what our team is trying to do. This is especially critical for heart failure patients because they often have other conditions. So they're seeing a lot of different kinds of providers as a result. This leads to many different kinds of tests and lab work, multiple medications, and all of this comes together in these electronic health record systems as massive amounts of data. This means that the many types of providers who they see, which include cardiologists, nurses, primary care doctors, pharmacists, and others who are caring for these heart failure patients, these people are often checking multiple sources before, during, and after a patient consultation in order to gather enough information just to make an informed decision about the care of these patients. So let's put ourselves in the doctor's shoes. Your appointments have run behind schedule and you haven't had time to review all of your cases for the day beforehand. Now you've got an appointment coming up with a complicated heart failure patient and you need to check their records. Yes, I blurred them on purpose, in order to piece together a picture of what's going on for your patient so you can help them. So during this 15-minute consultation with them, you have to check 5 different sets of records. And now, how are you feeling? Yeah, oh my goodness. We're not gonna even begin talking about a design analysis of what you just saw, but what I really wanna know is, are you ready to make an informed decision for your patient's care? Yeah, me neither. So in summary, the provider wants to pay attention to their patient. They're getting a lot of valuable information from them. They want to make that human connection. The patient wants the provider to pay attention to them. The provider often has to sift through large amounts of data before, during, and after appointments, which leads to an experience that's not exactly ideal for the patient or the provider. Our team's trying to fix it. The scramble for data is not uncommon. It can really detract from face-to-face interactions in the exam room, as indicated by our team's observational studies, as well as a recent survey that we conducted with over 300 providers who care for heart failure patients. From a design perspective, empowerment for providers lies not only in the successful design of a new interface that gives them confidence in seeing a comprehensive data picture for their patient, but also in our design process. In addition to the observational data and interviews that we conducted with various providers of heart failure patients, the team also empowered clinicians through using participatory design research. During this session, our team engaged clinicians in brainstorming and generating paper prototypes by using kits of materials to enable the providers to show us what their ideal interface would look like. So these kits included paper, markers, as well as pre-printed interface icons and imagery, and the clinicians pieced these together and enabled us to gain a lot of insights from this experience. So here a provider is actually telling me about how he's having trouble with the interface and how he would redesign certain elements of it in order to make the workflow better for him. Outside of the participatory design session, we also work with providers to evaluate paper prototypes of our interface design ideas at several points throughout our research and design process. So this is the current version of our updated new interface idea. And through a combination of observational and participatory approaches, we've identified specific pain points within this current EHR. So those are places where clinicians are running into problems and it's really affecting their workflow and experience with patients. So this includes, you know, trouble finding the necessary information that they need. Because of this, they're having a much slower response to the patient's worsening. And as I demonstrated earlier, you know, they're paying less attention to the patient and more attention to the electronic health records during in-person consultations. And with multiple types of providers, you might see different sets and probably need to access different software platforms for this comprehensive picture of the patient's health status. To address all these issues, UX design for a new dashboard empowers providers in clinic through an improved visual hierarchy that helps them get a quick and accurate handle on a patient's health information. And we're also experimenting with the ability to customize the way that they see this information. So if I know that I need to see lab work for a particular patient, I can put that information front and center. Our research team has also found the opportunity to discuss and share our different disciplinary values throughout this process. And these have been really instrumental in our mixed method research approach. The results of this research has actually come together to create a much clearer picture for us in terms of what's happening with the EHR use, how to improve it, and how to make more connection and better decision-making in clinic with patients. We're currently testing the most recent version of the interface with providers, and we plan to further refine the visual design of the interface based on their feedback. We're hoping to begin development within the next 6 months. We'll also be able to measure against our survey results to determine if our dashboard actually does reduce the amount of time that healthcare providers are accessing interfaces for their heart failure patients before, during, and after appointment. And I hypothesize and hope that this will show that they're able to get the information they need from the interface in a shorter amount of time, which also means they'll feel confident in quickly arriving at well-informed care decisions. And this means they'll be able to spend more time actively listening to their patients during appointments, which is something that both parties need and value. And what better ways to show respect for their patients' voices, time, and health? In addition to my interest in improving human connection between patients and providers, my research and design practice are also deeply connected to my lifelong commitment to social and racial equity and intercultural learning, as well as my interest in visual as well as virtual communication. Now, many of these things have really been converging for a lot of us lately in light of COVID-19 closures and restrictions and ongoing calls for racial justice worldwide. And I know that some of you may be wondering how I, as a white woman, became personally invested in these issues. For me, the conversations that we're having at a national level actually started at an early age. Because I grew up in the city of Richmond, Virginia, a city that was embroiled in discussions of race and equity throughout my childhood there, which continue even today, and where Black and white communities have recently been protesting and working together to bring down these symbols of the Confederacy and white supremacy. Speaking of working together across social boundaries, there's also a design lesson in my personal history lesson. So let's talk for a minute about the old redlining maps. Now, if you don't know what those are, these are the racist maps that were actually produced between 1935 and 1940 by the federal government, specifically for the Homeowners Loan Corporation, or HOLC. And these still affect racial segregation and economic status in many cities today. These maps are the reason that home ownership remains unattainable for many people and even entire communities. These maps are also a prime example of the dangerous power of visual communication to divide people and reinforce systemic racism. And, you know, they're just one example of the ways that visual and urban design have participated not only in injustice, as communicated by these maps, but full-on systemic inequality. So if you look at the map of Richmond, my childhood neighborhood was in an area that was a patchwork quilt of green, blue, yellow, and red up here in the north side. So the Homeowners Loan Corporation color coding system is based on income levels as well as race. Red neighborhoods were primarily lower income and black, while green neighborhoods were generally wealthy and white. Blue and yellow were in between. And in Hulk's terms, when it came to granting mortgage loans, they deemed green areas as, these are their words, best. Blue areas, still desirable. Yellow, definitely declining. And red, hazardous. And in many cities, because of these maps, the racial makeup and income levels of many neighborhoods, as I mentioned earlier, have not been able to change over time. My street was in a blue zone, and the notes on the map say that it's practically yellow. And the notes in the yellow neighborhood adjacent to it say it's too close to the red. So growing up, I lived in the midst of these racially and socioeconomically contrasting and still somewhat segregated neighborhoods. So I had a lot of questions about this. You know, I must have been an inquisitive child if I grew up to be a designer. My job is asking questions. So perhaps you can imagine that my positionality started a lot of discussions and helped me to start learning about systemic racism and white privilege from a young age. We did live in a big and beautiful old house, but even just a walk around my neighborhood or a trip to the grocery store showed me how lucky I was to live in that house and made me question why I had that privilege when neighbors so nearby did not. So I became attuned to and passionate about addressing racial, social, and gender inequities through allyship and advocacy. I went along with my parents to political rallies from a young age. Thanks, Mom, for the photo. And also, I was inspired by a lot of my parents' early work. My dad was a lawyer for the Virginia General Assembly, and my mom was a chief lobbyist for Virginia's Equal Rights Amendment. And you can see me here wearing my ERA Equal Rights Amendment Yes sticker in 1981. So if you're having a knee-jerk reaction to the sheer amount of red in this photo, I want to clarify for you that this is from the Virginia Democratic Convention. The color red was widely used to represent the Democratic Party prior to the 1980s, and the color schemes for the two major parties in the US were actually pretty mixed up in use by national news networks until the 2000 presidential election. So your association of the color red with a particular political affiliation is something that has been fixed and intensified through ongoing visual communication and media exposure over the past 20 years. This is an example of the power of visual culture, which is often driven by designers. Even if we aren't creating the messages ourselves, designers are creating the platforms through which other people share, create, and exchange their messages. So just think for a moment about the places where you get information on a daily basis, such as what passes through your social media feeds. What are the videos that you're choosing to watch? Through my parents' extensive civic involvement, I learned from them about hard work, but I also learned from them that if you have any kind of privilege in life, you have a responsibility to use it to empower others. A lot of time has passed since my formative years in Richmond, but these experiences shaped me and my academic interest in design, which as a discipline has really been grappling with its relationship to systemic racism and inclusion, particularly in the past few decades. Over time, I've come to realize that design can be a way to empower each other as humans, but issues of race, gender, interculturality, collaboration, and sustainability have historically been omitted from typical design curricula and are only starting to become part of the conversation now. So I became interested in developing a different kind of design. And because education practices are often the most effective way to transform a discipline, my research partner, Denielle Emans, and I have focused our efforts here in education. Acting as agents of change in design education, our research brings together students from universities in the United States, United Emirates, and Qatar to to learn how to work together, remotely, of course, by transcending cultural stereotypes and biases. And we're doing this in order to imagine and create together new ways to address global problems such as discrimination and environmental degradation, pandemics. Our new book, Intercultural Collaboration by Design, Drawing from Differences, Distances, and Disciplines Through Visual Thinking, offers a framework for effective intercultural learning and teamwork. And our series of more than 30 visual thinking methods enable people to learn how to relate to each other better and collaborate effectively together. We wrote this to be accessible to designers and non-designers alike. And we emphasize that people don't need to have any kind of sophisticated drawing or design skills or fancy software in order for these activities to work for their team. Since being published earlier this year, it's already been used in several different classrooms, such as an interaction design studio at California College of the Arts, who did several activities, including a fairy tale mashup, which you're seeing some example images from here. The fairy tale mashup is an activity that invites teammates to bring together stories, myths, or legends from their culture or community, and weave these together into a new narrative that can be conveyed in images, writing, animation, or other forms. According to their professor, Amy Bickerton, the team who created this fairy tale mashup, which they called Salt and Water, continued working together. She said they stuck together for the rest of the semester and they really excelled. I think the mashup was what helped them to make that connection. Meanwhile, a virtual global design studio in the urban planning program at Iowa State University actually structured the course's entire summer curriculum around our book, which enrolled 18 students from multiple nationalities, 5 different disciplines, and who had mixed undergraduate and graduate status. They were also collaborating with faculty and had a remote site based in Mexico. Their professor, Dr. Ben Shurtcliffe, took the opportunity to integrate our book as a means of training students how to work with remote teams and wanted to give them the skills and motivation needed not only to complete the studio, but also to be prepared for future working with remote teams. So you can see they incorporated about 25 of our activities within their short 8-week course. And this is a snapshot of their online workspace. It's just so exciting to see people not only using these methods, but actually excelling because of them. For these reasons, we're also hoping that workplaces, in addition to classrooms, will also find these activities and ways of thinking about collaboration useful as people navigate different fields of study, different professions, national borders, and other social and cultural barriers. We were really thinking about the process of intercultural teamwork as a design problem. And like all design problems, the process of intercultural teamwork also presents a unique learning opportunity for all participants. By studying cohorts over time, we were able to identify 6 key moments. These are typical challenges for teams that occurred at similar points in their process. We call these the 6 dimensions of intercultural teamwork. And our progression of visual thinking activities is structured around these 6 dimensions. We organize these based on parallels within the revised Bloom's taxonomy, which is a model for classifying learning objectives, as well as parallels within the design process itself. And by engaging with intercultural teamwork as both a learning experience and a design problem, participants are able to develop a growth mindset that encourages learning from each other by doing activities together or sharing outcomes with each other. And this experience, in turn, leads to evolving their ideas, not only about how to work together, but also about themselves and each other. So in the 6 chapters of our book, which are based on these 6 dimensions, design processes and visual thinking come together with the way people learn. And this is in order to offer a new view on how to tackle collaboration within diversity. Our goal in doing this research that informed the book was to develop activities that would encourage a sense of human connection and lead toward mutual respect and ultimately empower participants to work together in an equitable way. Our approach to creating the visual thinking activities and the way that they're organized in the book is to guide collaboration through this introspective process that helps individuals first reflect on their own working preferences and processes, as well as their own values, biases, and assumptions. And they do all of this before they actually meet their teammates. We were inspired by the sheer excitement of the students who participated in our initial collaborations, and we were also intrigued by the level of fear that they expressed in working together. They had concerns about what this actually meant to work together. How would it work for them to reveal aspects of their lives and personalities? Some of them were worried about saying something that would start World War III. We had a cohort that would do these really beautiful, in-depth written reflections and then redact them heavily before sharing them with their intercultural partners. We realized we needed much more direct addressing of stereotyping and bias prior to putting our teams together in order to open up conversations about how biases exist for all of us. But in order to do that, we had to first help students understand that their own personal and cultural values were guiding their thought process and ultimately their work together. So that's what these first two chapters are really about, establishing a foundation through in-depth self-discovery. This activity, the Team Think Constellation, is situated in chapter one and helps individuals get a handle on their teamwork preferences before meeting their partners. This can also be used later on when the team is assembled to help teammates understand and appreciate each other's differences up front. And in chapter two, value collages are an example of a preliminary activity that gives participants a way to reflect on and understand their personal and cultural values, including where these actually come from in the first place. One important part of these activities is their mutuality. So my students were doing these preliminary activities in parallel with Danielle's students. And just knowing that the other group of students is doing the same thing at the same time and having similar conversations gives all of them a sense of relief, but it also piques curiosity and interest. The outcomes of these initial activities also gives teammates something to talk about when they finally meet each other. So that mutuality comes forward in their initial conversations. They can show and share things. They can, you know, have a meaningful place to start their connection and something that's familiar to both of them, even if the outcomes of the activity and its contents look different. So this really helps when you think about bringing something to the table versus just showing up in a Zoom call where you don't know anyone and waiting for someone to say something first. From preliminary activities such as these, we encourage teammates to connect with each other and build trust in meaningful ways, particularly through visual storytelling. This process helps prepare them and gives them tools to navigate more challenging discussions related to project work. An example activity in this chapter is the picture story shuffle, which involves individuals thinking of a personal story to share, and then they draw five simple images to convey that story. They shuffle the order of the images before sharing them digitally with their teammates, and the receiving teammate guesses at the order of the images and the story they represent. Then they share their guess with the team, and the author of the story finally reveals their intended version. So not only does this process usually generate some laughs, but it also encourages curiosity and interest and people to share parts of themselves that they wouldn't typically do in regular small talk. This kicks off the collaboration in a meaningful and engaging way that invites many further questions, conversation, and discussion down the road. We then move on to topic exploration and, related to that, information sharing. So this is actually a really critical area because the different ways that people gather, validate, and therefore value information can be drastically different. And this can cause a lot of friction and problems if it's not managed and thought about upfront. These different ways of processing and valuing information can come from our different learning backgrounds, but they're also culturally informed. And while this is, you know, an area of surmountable difference, teammates have greatest success working through these differences if they're thinking about them upfront and agree to accept and consider perspectives that are not necessarily like their own. One activity in this chapter is called the perspective exchange, which invites teammates to shoot and share photographs of cultural phenomena in their communities or images related to a project topic. For example, our cohort, who is focused on creating projects around water sustainability in the Arabian Gulf and US Great Lakes regions, shot images representing their daily interactions with water to share with their teammates. This helped them compare, discuss, and understand their different experiences while also developing a deeper understanding for their shared project topic. Then in chapter 5, we address feedback exchange. Now, this is also known as critique in art and design circles, and it's a really important part of education and practice in most creative fields. But the word critique itself carries a lot of negative connotations for many people, particularly people hailing from cultures that prioritize social harmony. So we focus on helping people understand indirect and direct styles of communication in relation to feedback exchange and how to give and receive constructive feedback that makes the recipient and giver feel as though they have some agency in the process. We also discuss how to incorporate creativity, visualizations, and playful elements into the process of feedback exchange. This helps make the experience engaging regardless of the delivery format. And finally, in our last chapter, we encourage the team to co-create together. We offer a roadmap to help teams figure out their roles and goals in working together and how to co-create a project of their own making. We also walk through a few examples of some low-stakes collaborative activities, such as the fairy tale mashup that I mentioned earlier and showed examples from students at California College of the Arts. So this final chapter encourages sharing and creative remixing among teammates and also encourages them to share outcomes of their collaborations publicly. What our work in intercultural collaboration means for design is a fundamental shift in power. It's not about a me or doing design as a lone genius in a white Western cultural vacuum. It's about co-constructing a we. It's of course important for designers to remember that we are not the same as our audiences and that we therefore must learn from them and with them. But it's also critical for us to understand that the historically limited definition of who gets to be a designer must also shift. Because design itself is a superpower that can misinform or educate. It can divide or connect us. So how did all of this begin? Well, stepping back into my past again for a moment, I mentioned earlier my interest in visual as well as virtual communication. While I was learning about social justice during my childhood in Richmond, I also ended up taking courses from home during high school due to a medical condition. These courses were not online like they are now. This was in the pretty early days of public internet access. So even though this was long before things like social media or even smartphones for that matter, I saw the internet as an opportunity to try to mediate my social isolation and also supplement my education by forging virtual friendships with people from around the globe. I was always interested in art, theater, writing, and other creative forms of expression, and during that challenging time in my life, I dove into these interests even more as outlets to process what was happening to me. But I also used this as a way to make these international friendships. This happened mostly through online forums where I could communicate with people about mutual interests in things like music or art, and some of them became pen pals, and down the road, we even had some in-person visits. Fast forwarding to 2011, I was riding the bus to teach one of my classes at the University of San Francisco the moment all of this started to really converge for me. Because I saw a social media post from Denielle Emans on my phone. She was then my acquaintance, and now has since become my long-term research partner and dear friend. Danielle had just started teaching in a graphic design program in Dubai, so based on my interests and personal history, it probably doesn't seem far-fetched that I would quickly send her a message to ask if she'd be interested in trying out an experiment to bring two very culturally different groups of students together through collaborative design projects. As I mentioned, I was teaching as an adjunct at the University of San Francisco and also working as a UX strategist and designer for a consultancy with international clients. And this combination had me thinking about how we address these kinds of topics in multiple spaces. For example, what is the role of education, particularly design education, in talking about the influence of media and visual communication on discrimination? Then, on the other hand, at my UX job, how can we overcome some of the unspoken social and cultural barriers between us and our clients in other countries? The challenges we all felt weren't necessarily about time differences, they were about cultural differences. Could these become assets to our work together somehow? Over the past 9 years, this project of designing visual thinking activities, such as the Team Think Constellation, the value collages, the fairy tale mashup, to support remote intercultural collaborations, has followed us through 5 different academic institutions as we studied how different cohorts of design students based in the Middle East and North America learn to work together. And the 230 participants in our study have actually hailed from over 23 different countries. So even though they've been based at these 5 institutions, they're really from all over the world. Even before the COVID pandemic, study abroad was not widely available to most students in the United States or globally. While these numbers are specific to the United States, the global study abroad rate is also around 2% of all post-secondary students. You can see that of 20 million students enrolled in the 2017 and 18 school year, this is the most recent year for which this data is available, less than 3% of these students from the United States studied abroad. And specific to our study, only about 2% of that number chose locations in the Gulf region. Global pandemics notwithstanding, reasons for low study abroad participation are not just financial. Issues of academic credit transfers, finding applicable programs, language competency, concerns for safety, all these things keep students around the world from venturing to learn firsthand from other cultures. And for the students who do go, cultural learning can be diluted. Students are often put into programs or courses with other students from their own home country, or they self-segregate into similar groups. And unless they're living with a host family, a visiting student's interaction with the host culture, let alone having a collaboration with them, could range from minimal to non-existent. Along these lines, it's also important to note who has the privilege of studying abroad. Students who identify as Caucasian represent 56% of college and university enrollment, but 70% of the United States study abroad population. So design is not the only area where we need to improve inclusion. The idea of doing online virtual exchanges for those students who have access to the tools actually transcends a lot of barriers and extends opportunities to various groups of people in many ways. So what Denielle and I are doing is really the tip of the iceberg. There is so much potential here. And with the pandemic, the opportunity for intercultural collaboration is critical, both from a public health perspective as well as a political perspective. We need to be working together to help each other through this from so many different angles. As study abroad programs have been shut down and many students continue studying from home and global travel is restricted, educators around the world should be concerned about how these actions might fuel division and nationalism. Even as planes are grounded and leaders have tightened borders, education has the power to keep the world connected. Danielle and I had already seen the power of collaboration in our own design practices and individual classrooms, but we thought in the context of an intercultural collaboration, students from our respective schools and continents could achieve so much more together. And what this started for us actually turned into a long-term research agenda that motivates and drives me now more than ever. We began creating opportunities for students from our respective institutions to collaborate remotely together, usually on topics related to global challenges. We typically introduce some of the visual introspection activities first, like the Team Think Constellation or the Value Collage. as well as a prompt for what their project will be. And then after the teams are formed, and once the teammates have actually met each other, we introduce some additional activities that help them get to know each other and begin to build trust, such as that picture story shuffle. We also observe how the activities work and observe the project processes and the collaboration outcomes. While the teams are working together to create something and they're drawing during this time from those activities that help them think about topics from many angles, such as the perspective exchange, they're learning about feedback exchange in terms of indirect and direct communication, and they're determining how to move forward together with their project ideas, we as researchers are reflecting. We're writing about our observations, and we're making notes about how to revise and update the activities. And after a collaboration ends, we're often updating or creating new activities, which we'll try out with the next cohort of collaborators. In the bigger picture sense, we are comparing how these activities work from one cohort to the next and looking for patterns, which over time can be the basis for developing new theory. This process of comparing qualitative information over time in the interest of developing new theory is called a grounded theory approach. Some of the patterns that we found that are applicable to the current situation of many people who are working remotely is that participants prefer activities and communication that involve some kind of social presence. That means they need to feel like there's a human involved in some way. While synchronous in-person conversations, like you see in the top right of this diagram, were not possible for our collaborative teams, as they are not now for many of us, other approaches, such as real-time video conversations or even pre-recorded videos, as you see in the top left, exchanged between teammates, would make them feel engaged and motivated. Texting, which could be synchronous or asynchronous, depending on the situation, was also somewhat engaging and motivational, especially when participants exchanged images, voice notes, or emojis, and all of these things really contribute to a sense of social presence. But certain communication modes, like email, were not very effective because they have the lowest social presence of all, and because many of our participants were communicating in a second language, writing an email felt more like a stressful task to some of them than using some of these other approaches. Additionally, our teams worked remotely, of course, but almost universally preferred the visual thinking activities that had some kind of tangible, physical, or hands-on component associated with them. And this finding is consistent with theories of multisensory and multi-channel learning, which basically say that our brains are more stimulated when receiving information through different senses. So when we draw or write something by hand, we're sharing part of our unique selves in that process, as well as engaging multiple senses. Seeing a photograph of a teammate's handwritten sticky note can be actually a visual signifier of that person as an individual. So there's a very personal part of this, as well as the sensorial aspect. We find that creating and exchanging images that are sketched, photographed, or created through some other means can make the online activities for people feel a lot more real and can make people feel more committed to an otherwise online-only project or virtual teammates. So if you have been working or studying from home a lot lately, staring at a computer screen for pretty much all of your tasks and communications with people, you might be feeling pretty burned out because your visual channel is overloaded. And everything your visual channel is processing through the screen is totally flat. So I think a really critical finding from our research that is useful in this very moment for many of us is to make time to do activities away from the screen. Try to relegate some of your screen-based tasks to paper-based activities. I keep a sketchbook and a pen parked by my computer, and I use it to alleviate some of this screen fatigue. Maybe you are actually moving some of your text-based tasks to something like sketching. It's still visual, but doing that on paper by hand engages your brain in a very different way than just typing words on a screen. The moment in my personal history when I was reaching out to people across the world through the internet stuck with me and gave me early personal experience in the area of forging remote international relationships, as well as a strong belief in the work that we're doing today. However, we're asking people to take it a step further than I did back when I was making friends through forums in high school. They're not just connecting, they're actually learning from each other and striving to collaborate. Successful collaboration is a learned process. It must be practiced. It doesn't happen naturally, and it's a much harder thing to do than to just communicate with someone. But collaboration is also more effective in building both human connection and cultivating a sense of empowerment, because intercultural collaboration, by definition, introduces new voices to the conversation and gives everyone a chance to be heard. And while collaborating across borders is not easy, whether they are disciplinary, cultural, national, or social, or depicted on a map created decades ago by the federal government, just starting this process of collaboration presents a barrier to many people. The collaborators in our study have been put together in teams in meaningful ways by me and my research partner. We often use common interests in a topic to form our teams, but in the wild, finding collaborators is not easy. So Danielle and I are very aware that partnerships like ours do not come along every day. And related to both my book and the experience on that managed heart failure decision dashboard project that I discussed earlier, I've also been working on a tool to help more teams come together. So my hope is that bringing people together will enable them to do more of this kind of work that's crossing these disciplinary, national, and social borders. This platform is called Orbit, which stands for Online Resource for Building Intercultural Teams. As with my work on the Managed Heart Failure Dashboard, over the past 3 years, I've also brought a multi-generational and multidisciplinary team together to work on Orbit, from first-year engineering students to recent graduates of our Masters of Integrative Design program at Stamps. And during that time, we've conducted surveys, interviews, and participatory design activities, such as card sorting and paper prototype testing, as you see an example of here. We've done this with faculty who are interested or already engaged in international virtual classroom exchanges, as well as talking with organizations across our campus that support different types of collaboration. All of this has informed the conceptual model and functionality of our platform. We recently launched a beta version, which is currently serving academics who are interested in pursuing global challenges and in doing this through research or teaching partnerships. So if you are an academic and this interests you, we invite you to sign up at orbit-teams.com. This video shows the profile creation process, which is the basis for finding collaborators and matches on the platform. Our goal in launching this early version of the platform is to work out the essential capabilities of the site, but we also want to start building a community of people who would feel empowered to connect with each other for teaching and research collaboration. In creating a profile, I can tell people a little bit about myself, my interests, and I can also add collaboration goals to my profile. We're using the list of United Nations Sustainable Development Goals as a starting point to help people ground their partnerships in actionable topics of global concern. So if I already have an idea for a teaching or research collaboration, I can also add that to the site. But we also want to empower people to connect with each other and come up with their own ideas together, even if they don't come to Orbit with a collaboration idea already in mind. If I do opt to create an idea, however, I'm also invited to add the UN Sustainable Development Goals to that idea as well, but these don't have to be exactly the same as the ones in my personal profile. So, what this system does is enable people to see matches of people or ideas who have overlapping goals, and you can also search based on keywords and profiles and the descriptions of the ideas. Based on my own experiences in leading intercultural collaborations in the classroom, I think the goal-driven approach will lead to new intersections of people beyond their typical disciplinary or geographical circles who are coming together in a meaningful way due to their shared big picture interests. In the future, it's going to do so much more. In addition to improving the user experience and visual design of the platform, we're currently looking for funding to further build this out by adding support for some of the visual thinking activities from the book, such as the Team Think Constellation. And we're looking at how this could support the formation and progress of teams at various educational levels, such as secondary learners in 6th to 8th grade, high schoolers in 9th to 12th grade, and undergraduate and graduate students at colleges, community colleges, and universities. What we found right now is that the online learning management systems that are used in most secondary and higher education environments are mostly limited to just automatically generating teams of students within the same academic course. And the teams that are generated are done pretty arbitrarily through an algorithm. This is unfortunately the case whether teams are generated automatically by a system or pulled out of a hat by a teacher. So what you're seeing here are currently my options for automatically or manually generating teams in the learning management system that we use at University of Michigan. And just shuffling students randomly into groups and then telling them, go forth and collaborate, is not enough. Collaboration needs more support than just have a video call and figure it out. And at the present moment, with so many schools closed by necessity across the country, existing resources to support students' peer-to-peer learning are pretty limited. Now, as a parent and educator, this concerns me, but even if you're not a parent or educator, you should still care about this as a resident of planet Earth, because we desperately need future generations who have the sensitivity and interpersonal competencies to work together creatively in addressing whatever might be coming at us next, because it's coming. We need better tools to support and teach collaboration. And I can't blame students for not feeling enthusiastic about working together in groups that are created in this random way. But great collaborations are possible if people learn how to do them effectively. Research indicates that while unprepared teams often perform at lower levels than individuals just working alone, high performance teams, those are the ones who've actually learned how to work together, generally achieve better and more sophisticated results. So what if we could offer something that would bring students together to learn from each other's very different perspectives while also supporting them in learning how to work together on a project? Imagine being in 9th grade and learning about intercultural collaboration by being partnered with students across school, your country, or even across the globe. And these partners would be put together because you actually care about a similar topic. Maybe water sustainability, maybe access to education, gender equality, cultural preservation. Making this common interest a focus of the project that you do together will help bond you together as teammates as well and make you invested in actually learning how to work together. We hope to create a robust resource that's going to support the meaningful creation of student teams within individual classes as well as between schools and at a local, national, and international level. This presents great opportunities for continued research, particularly in acknowledging how to support students in developing their ability to connect and work with people who are not like themselves. And yes, I realize there are some serious questions of socioeconomic diversity, equity, and access that come into play when we talk about any kind of online learning or technological tools. The pandemic has really brought this longstanding and important conversation to the forefront. But we're also missing a critical opportunity if people who do have access to the tools don't use them productively right now. Because tools themselves are just a means to an end. We need to better use them for human connection. And that is a learned process. Working together across differences is not second nature. It is not something people intuitively know how to do. It's messy and it's challenging because people are messy and challenging, and that's okay. The reality of living with the pandemic is that we all need to adapt and that we need to be much more resilient in our working, our teaching, and our learning. That resiliency must account for peer-to-peer interactions and collaborations, which are not just essential for an individual's social and emotional learning and growth and well-being, but also for helping humans to learn from each other and work together. Creating opportunities to work together is the most powerful way we can counteract the challenges and effects of isolation, not just on our individual psyches, but also in the ways we learn to live with and respect each other, and how we build out our shared vision for the future. Because COVID has given people worldwide a shared experience, even though it manifests differently for everyone, this is an opportune time to reach out to each other using the tools at hand, build on each other's skills, and continue to connect now more than ever. Because coming together is how we make change. And the work we do in collaboration with each other essentially creates new monuments to the future of kindness, respect, equity, and human connection. Working together is the only way we can co-create that better future. In healthcare settings, in the classroom, and beyond. I hope this leaves you feeling inspired and empowered to continue forging human connections and to find ways to work together, not in spite of differences, but because of them, even in this age of physical distance. It has truly been a privilege to share my work with you today, and I want to say a special thank you to all of my collaborators for working with me and for all the amazing contributions you've made to our work together. I'm excited for what we'll do.